So guys, the last shader video kinda exploded and you wanted more. It's the same deal as last time. You keep liking and commenting, I keep explaining shaders. Shaders always look so intimidating, but honestly, they are not complicated. They are just really, really strange. But once you got used to them, you can make amazing stuff really fast. This is because many effects tend to use the same simple techniques and just combine them in a new way. We already covered grayscale, screen reading, and mapping stuff to a gradient. Another thing that is almost always the answer is texture scrolling. If you look for it, you can find it in a ton of effects. We start with a looping texture. The easiest way to create one is to use a noise texture with open simplex noise and make sure seamless is enabled. We add a shader and sample the texture at its UV. And we can see a bit of black and white noise. We can make it scroll by adding a vector that we multiply with the time built in. This way, whenever the time is advanced, the UVs are calculated differently. The scrolled UVs are not between 0 and 1 anymore, but that's okay since our texture is wrapping, and that makes it basically infinite. Here's how it would look without the seamless flag. If you want, you can play around and put a sign around the time to make it oscillate, or multiply it with a sign of the time to make it zoom in and out. Play around and put a sign in different places. But for this effect, we just keep it moving forever. Let's make the scroll a uniform so we can change it. When we change it at runtime by sliding the value, we see very strange movement. This is because the texture does not move incrementally. Instead, the position is calculated based on the time, independent of the last frame. So when we change the scrolling speed, it moves where it would have been if it moved like that from the start. In case this is ever a problem, remove the time builder and animate a complete scroll directly. We now add another noise texture by adding a uniform sampler to D and sample it. Don't forget to make it seamless again. It needs its own scroll uniform, just like we did for the first one. We now multiply the color values to get the overlapping brightness. Let's call it the energy. When we write it to the color, we see quite organic morphing around. Based on the scrolling speeds and the properties of the noise, it can look very different. We can add color by adding another texture as sampler to D. This time we use a gradient. Based on how bright the image is, we sample a different point on the gradient. So the black pixels get this part on the left, and the white pixels this part on the right. We can make a lot of different effects with this. Let's start with a fire. The low energy parts should be invisible. After that, we make black for the smoke, and then red and yellow. You should play around a lot with this gradient. You can make the color transition sharper. It generally looks good to have some non-linear parts, so you see more of the morphing. We can adjust the scroll to make the fire go upwards. One remaining problem is that we still have sharp borders. This just looks bad. Also, fire should fade out. So what if we reduce the energy at the top of the image? Subtract 1 minus UVY from the energy so that there's no energy left at the very top. Since the average energy is around 0.5 before the step, we get pretty small energy values. So add a factor of 0.5. We can also boost the gradient a bit to make up for it. If we want, we can also sample another texture instead and multiply it to the energy. That way we can bend it in the craziest shapes, as we did here with burning text. We can level the whole effect up by using custom noise. For these, we typically use Krita because it has a wraparound mode. You can draw flames if you want flames, bubbles if you want bubbles, electric sparks if you want, or even skulls or whatever. Import them and make sure the repeat flag is set or it will not show up. So for the flame effect, we use flames. Of course, you can make them green or black, I won't judge you. And for the water spell, you could use bubbles and color the gradient blue. For a water effect like we made in our game Sisyphus Fungeon, we combined texture scrolling with distortion. We also added white to the high energy parts. Another effect that you can find almost everywhere is a dissolve. For its simplest form, we sample the texture. Then we calculate the pixel's brightness, which is its grayscale value. Add another uniform that describes how dissolved the texture is. Whenever the dissolve value is higher than the pixel's brightness, simply don't draw it. We could do this with an if, but because branching is difficult for GPUs, there's also the step function. It returns 0 when the first argument is larger and 1 otherwise. When we look at its graph, we see it looks like a step. The first parameter, the dissolve uniform, defines where the step is. And if the brightness is below the dissolve, the output is 0. And if it's higher, the output is 1. We can just multiply the alpha with that. And now our image disappears. By the way, there's also the smooth step function, which looks like this. It has 3 parameters, the left and the right border of the transition and the value to compare. You should play around with it. But for now, let's get back to the dissolve. You usually will find a more complex variant of the dissolve. We You can also use it for a nice electrical type effect. For this, calculate the distance between the pixel's brightness and the dissolve value. If it is below a certain threshold, maybe add a little color. You now have this flash wandering around. You can customize it, make it multiple ones, etc. Often another texture is used for the dissolve. For this, take another uniform sampler 2D, give it a noise. It can be generated, it can be custom. Usually it's in grayscale. You can sample the brightness from there and don't even have to average the color values, because they are all the same anyway. You can also combine flashing and removing for a burn type effect. And of course, we can combine it with a gradient texture. For this, sample your sprite, calculate the grayscale and map it to the gradient, like we did in the first video. But now subtract the dissolve value from the brightness. When we set our gradient up correctly, with transparency at the left, we can see that it disappears. This can be used for a lot of visual effects, like a snowflake melting. In most cases, you would like many snowflakes at once, which is where a particle system shines. And we can make a particle system out of every effect with some trickery. Add a particle system and give it a snowflake texture. Now go all the way down and add our shader. We can see them and they are nice, but they all melt together, and this is not great. To distinguish particles, we'll need the particle lifetime in the fragment shader. Luckily, the lifetime can be accessed from the vertex function in instance custom Y. To demonstrate it, we can multiply it to the vertex position. But we cannot access the instance custom down here in the fragment function. For this, we need a varying. Varyings are variables that exist for each vertex. In this case, each particle has four vertices with the same instance custom. So each pixel of the particle will have the same value in it. But different particles can have different values. We can just write the lifetime into the varying and read that in the fragment shader. Shader effects are made by layering different techniques. And we already used a lot of layers. We used grayscale here. We used mapping stuff to a gradient. We kinda dissolved, but we plugged it into a particle system. And no one would stop us from reading the screen or doing texture scrolling on that. These effects here are done using texture scrolling on particles, for example. We made a video about that specifically. If this video was helpful to you, please give it a like. As long as you guys are interested, I can go on forever.